When the Pacific Northwest's feared Big One earthquake eventually strikes, it is likely to devastate large swaths of Washington, Oregon, California, and British Columbia. Such an event could involve an earthquake of up to magnitude 9.3, generate up to 35-meter or 115-foot-high tsunamis, and cause the following number of casualties and damage. These numbers are rightfully quite horrifying, but the good news is that these large numbers can be reduced by upwards of 80% given only a little bit of infrastructure and upgrades to buildings. For proof of this concept, I have a real-life example due to a contact I have who has lived in the state of Washington upwards of 45 years. All the way back in 1980, when my contact, who I will give an alias of Sam, was a landlord who rented out a set of properties to various tenants. One day, she received a notice that an engineer had arrived to perform an optional inspection of her properties as part of a new initiative by the state to reduce future earthquake damage before it occurs. She could have hypothetically turned down the inspection, but was rightfully concerned about her tenants, so she allowed the inspection to take place. When the results came in, they weren't pretty. To reduce earthquake risk, which was now known, the entire structure housing the elevator would need to be completely rebuilt, completely new decks would be needed for each floor, and other renovations would be needed, which cost in the hundreds of thousands of dollars at the time. Well, those improvements ended up proving their worth. 21 years later, a strong magnitude 6.8 earthquake struck between Seattle and Olympia, causing $4 billion in damage. While many adjacent buildings received some form of damage, including two structures that were red-tagged, the improved apartment complex received no damage. These improvements, while costly, had not only potentially saved lives, but, if you are looking at this only from an economic angle, actually ended up costing less in the long run due to earthquake damage not occurring, and prevented a lawsuit from ever being made. What I just described is an ideal outcome of what could occur were every regional structure to have received the same upgrades. I will now outline a few upgrades which can be made. First, building materials. In general, non-reinforced brick or masonry structures almost always come away with the heaviest damage of common building materials in an earthquake, with non-reinforced concrete faring the second worst. In contrast, wood fares the second best, while reinforced steel fares the best. The reason for this comes down to the flexibility or ductility of the building materials, which can accommodate the motion created by an earthquake. But fear not, even if you happen to live in or own properties almost completely composed of brick, masonry, or concrete, you can make them more resistant via having their structures reinforced with steel rebar. This process is especially important on what are termed soft story structures. Second, liquefaction damage that is unlikely to occur on a base of hard bedrock, but far more likely to occur on a basement of soft sediment, such as commonly found adjacent to a beach. To reduce the chance of liquefaction damage, which can cause a building regardless of its design to sink as the ground underneath it unevenly subsides, there are several options. This includes artificially increasing the density of underlying soil by compacting it, replacing underlying soil with gravel as this allows the soil to drain water more easily, and the placement of thick stone columns underground. Other methods can be used to reduce earthquake damage, but I will now turn to reducing tsunami heights. While the following methods are best at reducing damage caused by minor tsunamis with wave heights under 5 meters, they can also reduce damage and deaths during taller tsunamis. Methods include, but are not limited to, placing one or more breakwater walls, placing seawalls in high-risk areas, placing walls to redirect tsunami waves towards uninhabited low-lying areas, and slow down the speed of a tsunami advance onto land with very dense vegetation, preferably rows of decades-old trees with deep root systems and walls. None of these methods will truly prevent a major tsunami from inundating structures, but a combination of these methods that includes breakwater walls can reduce the maximum run-up height a tsunami reaches in the best of circumstances by upwards of 50%. So, for example, a maximum run-up height of 35 meters or 115 feet could be reduced to 17 meters or 56 feet. These methods can also give multiple additional minutes of time for people to evacuate. As a final note, an important factor to make sure exists is that any reasonable evacuation route is on fairly high terrain, which will not get cut off by the initial portion of a tsunami.